Hi.
Yeah, this works. Okay, awesome. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Sonja, and I have gone from being an assistant director in Hollywood to working in VFX to working in AAA games. Yeah, these are some of the projects I've worked on. Now, today I'm going to talk a little bit about how I got to where I am today. I'm also going to talk a little bit about some of the projects I worked on and some of the lessons I learned. My hope for this talk is to inspire you and to hopefully motivate you to keep moving forward even when things don't work out the way you planned them to. Because they rarely do. At least in my life, they don't. So, life is full of curveballs. And if you go along with it, you might just be surprised where you end up. It might be somewhere so much better than you could have ever anticipated it. So embrace the journey, do more, learn more, and see where life takes you. We don't have all day, so I'm going to skip through some parts, and that way I can focus on others. And one of the things I'm not going to talk about today is how I became an assistant director. That is a full-length talk all on its own. What does an assistant director do? An assistant director basically ensures that every day on set runs as smooth as possible, that the director has everything they need to execute their vision. We communicate to the cast and crew, we create the schedules and the reports, we also manage budgets and union requirements. We're essentially the glue that ties all departments together. Now, on a film set with 110, plus crew members, there are a lot of moving elements. Everybody has different priorities, so it's your job as an AD to sort through everything, come up with a plan, and then execute that plan on time and on budget. It's a tough job, and a pretty thankless job as well, because you're the person telling everybody to work faster. Nobody likes that person, nobody likes being that person, but somebody's got to do it. You also work really long hours. You, when you work on a TV show for 9 months out of the year, you spend more time with the crew than you spend with your own family. But you get to do incredible cool things. You also get to meet really cool people. For example, on Timeline, we built a full-scale castle, and then we blew it up with trebuchets. I mean, how cool is that? And on Team America, we got to listen to Matt and Trey just come up with songs and tell us stories on the set. Because we had a lot of downtime, the strings on the puppets were extremely long. And that was due to camera requirements and set requirements. And because of that, they would rip all the time. So we had a lot of downtime. One of the main skills you learn as an assistant director is to stay calm under pressure and to come up with a new solution. Things rarely work out as planned. I've mentioned that before, and that is true as well. Strings rip, actors don't show up, rental farms crash. It doesn't matter which industry you work in, things don't always work out as you anticipate and as you plan for them. So to be able to roll with the punches, regardless, or actually without complaining, really, and being able to come up with new solutions to solve different problems will make you an invaluable member on any team, regardless of the industry. So life was great. It was awesome. Until, in 2008, the Writers Guild decided to go on strike. The strike lasted for only about 100 days, but it changed Hollywood dramatically. Not only was the entire industry out of work for months at a time, it also opened the door to reality TV. A lot of jobs were simply gone when we came back. So it was during this time that I saw a presentation about the VFX on 2012. Yes, it's a place. When I saw this breakdown, I was completely blown away by it. I had never seen anything like it before, and I wanted to know how to do it. So I had nothing better to do anyways. I was unemployed, and there's only so many yoga classes you can take. So I asked some VFX supervisors I knew, and they recommended I take a couple classes at Noman School of VFX in Los Angeles. And that's what I did. I went to one of their open houses, and I signed up for a couple of classes. At Noman, I really started to get a glimpse into the VFX world. I started to go back into drawing and painting, which I hadn't done in 10 years at that point, and had a lot of fun. I also had a lot of time to think, right? The strike had given me a lot of time to reevaluate my life, and I had to admit that I had done a lot of work. So I decided it was time for a change, and I enrolled in Noman's 2-year full-time program. The beginnings were very humbling. I had never heard of Maya or even polygons, so I really started at the very bottom. Doesn't get lower than that, I knew nothing. And to show you I'm not kidding, this is my intro to Maya final. I clearly had just discovered bump maps and was super excited to use them. Hadn't quite figured out UVs yet though, but eventually I figured things out thanks to some great teachers. And I decided that I wanted to become, there we go, now I'm in shock. And I decided to become a matte painter. Noman didn't offer a matte painting track, so I'd signed up for the generalist track instead, and I made it a personal goal of mine to incorporate as many matte paintings into as many homework assignments as I could, very much to the delight of my teachers. So, if the assignment was to light and render a car, I threw in a landscape. If the assignment was to do a fluid sim twister, I threw in a destroyed gas station. Why not? I also took classes outside of Noman. I participated in online matte painting competitions, and I reached out to professionals in the industry like Dylan Cole. I was very persistent. I knew I had a lot of catching up to do. I hadn't drawn or painted in 10 years, and I wanted to be able to get a job as a matte painter after 2 years. All the effort paid off, I'm happy to say. I got an offer from Rhythm and Hughes before I had even graduated. Very exciting. This brings me to this. Don't be afraid to forge your own path. You know, it's your life. Follow your dreams. There wasn't a matte painting track for me to take, so I sort of made one for myself. You can do the same. RNH was an amazing place to work at. We had a fantastic team. This was where I first learned Linux and, you know, how important it is to be nice to your pipeline TD because things break. I also got to experience working with proprietary software for the first time. RNH used Rampage. That was their proprietary software they used for camera projections. Great software, by the way. Really awesome. And my very first project I got to work on was Into the Storm. So you can imagine I did a lot of sky replacements and plate cleanups. I also experienced what it's like when one of your shots gets cut from the film for the first time. And that stung. I liked that shot. But in the end, I had to admit that, all right, the movie was better without it, so fair enough. So I was at R&H for about 4 months. Until a Sunday night, I got a phone call from one of my friends and coworkers telling me that she just read an article in the Hollywood Reporter that R&H had filed for bankruptcy. And that's how we found out. This was a very surreal experience. We didn't know what to expect. We didn't know who was let go and who wasn't. So we sort of showed up the next day, just aimlessly wandering the halls, waiting for our friends to show up. It was a very strange and bizarre feeling, and I hope none of you ever have to experience. It definitely reminded me that nothing in life is perfect, and yay for that career change. It also reinforced the importance of having a safety net. Have enough savings to last you at least 6 months, just in case something happens and you lose your job, or you want to make a change and you want to change careers. Have that buffer that you don't, you know, that you're not stressed out about it. Also, make sure that you don't just rely on professional work for your portfolio, because you may not get access to that work. Warner Brothers pulled everything we did on Into the Storm and gave it to another VFX house to finish. We lost everything we did on it. And the artists, I had colleagues that were on R&H for many, many years, they were locked out of their computers. So make sure you have personal work to supplement your professional work. It was not a fun time. I'm not gonna lie about it, it wasn't fun. But life does go on. For me, it was in the form of one of my classmates and friends, and he put in a good word for me, and before I knew it, I had another job. I went to the mill next. At the mill, I got a chance to work on a couple of Chevy commercials. And commercials were interesting for me because they had much faster turnarounds, but they also used 3D a lot more. And I got to do some 3D, which was awesome. I actually got to use some of those generalist skill sets that I had. And this was actually the first assignment I did while I was there. Then I got to work on these Adidas climate warm commercials. The concept for them was to mirror the starting location at the end. So we basically had to create a flipped version of the beginning. Because of the nature of these spots, we had to use different techniques for each of them. This one, for example, had a static background, so I could do a matte painting projected onto the geometry. This one had moving elements baked into the plate. So I had to take the footage, project it into Nuke, and do my paint adjustments there. Very different techniques to solve the same problem. The more you know, the better. I was initially hired only for those Chevy commercials, but because I knew Maya and Nuke, I was able to get my contract extended. It's just, it is helpful in this industry. The more you know, you can fill gaps and you become more valuable. After the mill, I also worked on a couple of TV shows at Stargate Studios, and then one day, I got a phone call from ILM, asking me if I'd be interested in joining their generalist apprenticeship program. Now, the generalist department is responsible for creating photoreal environments using a variety of different techniques, anything from photography to matte painting to full 3D. They basically cover the entire pipeline, anything from modeling to look dev to lighting, rendering, pre-comp, everything. I said yes, of course, it's ILM. So I packed my bags, and I was off to San Francisco. Super excited. Yes, the year is finally turning out to be better. Sort of. My car broke down on the way there, in the middle of nowhere, nothing but cows. I had like one bar left on my phone, just enough to get me a tow truck and get me out of there. So later on, I found out that it had actually been Shannon Wiggins, our placement manager at Noman, who had given my name to the ILM recruiters. It's a small world, small industry. It's super important to be nice and respectful to everyone you meet. Your next recommendation could come from anywhere. So at ILM, Richard Bluff was our department head at the time, and he had handpicked 5 of us for the apprenticeship program. We were tasked with creating a 5-shot sequence of the Millennium Falcon getting chased by TIE fighters through an asteroid field. We had the Millennium Falcon, we had its animation, we had the camera animation and the previs. Everything else was up for us to create. We took it upon ourselves to meet up after work one day, and we sort of decided to split up tasks between us. And I took it a step further, you know, production background and all, and created a schedule. It was a very basic schedule, but it did include deadlines of when we needed certain assets to be done, and it included a week of buffer time, just in case something went wrong. After the year I had, I was sure something was going to go wrong, right? And of course it did. This. We had to do the entire sequence in 3ds Max and V-Ray. But I knew V-Ray from school, and I love V-Ray, so that was good. But this, I had opened it once and never again. The rest of the team felt the same way. So we were hoping that somebody would teach us how to use 3ds Max. Came to find out, they weren't. We were expected to figure it out by ourselves. Of course, we had a lot of amazing, talented artists sitting around us that we could ask, but they were working on complex, intricate transformer scenes, right? I'd never seen so many polygons on a single screen. So it felt really, really wrong, like, to go up to them and be like, hey, where's the hypershade? You know, I just felt really wrong. Can't do that. So for the most part, I tried to figure things out by myself. Google was a great help. But really, you'd be amazed by how fast you can learn things when you have a deadline coming up. Miracles can happen. What that taught me, though, is that at the end of the day, it is my responsibility to know the tools. And it's also I'm responsible for knowing the best tools for the job, not just a single tool. 3ds Max, for example, is amazing at working with splines. Maya at the time wasn't. It's gotten a lot better now, but every software is very good at some things, maybe not quite as good at others. It's important to know those differences. I learned another very important lesson through my friend Tiffany. Tiffany was the modeler in the group, and she was tasked with modeling a TIE fighter in a day, 8 hours. This is her final model. Having that kind of tight time constraint really pushes you to focus on what's important. In this case, what are the shapes I need to get in here to tell the viewer this is a TIE fighter? The next day, our lead came back and was like, hey, I changed my mind. Let's do an interceptor instead. Oh yeah, and it's due again, end of the day. Good luck. So she scrapped everything, started again, and this is what she came up with. And again, this was a fantastic exercise on multiple levels, right? Not only was it an exercise in time management and learning to make smart decisions in order to hit a deadline, but it also was a lesson in not getting attached to your work. And I've mentioned it before, but it really is a recurring theme in what we do. It's not fun, but it is a reality of being a production artist. Then there were a lot of other things that happened. Some of us at some point got pulled to work on other projects, so we were people short. Then we couldn't use the render farm because Transformers was finishing up. But eventually, somehow, very last minute, we got a first pass out on the entire sequence. Do you guys want to see it? Yeah? All right. Don't expect too much. That was it. Oh, thanks. So after the apprenticeship, I was offered a permanent position, and Tomorrowland was my first show.
When I touch this pin, I saw this place. Someplace amazing. And it felt like anything was possible. And then it was gone.
What do you want?
I want you to take me to the place I saw when I touched this.
Where'd you get that?
I know that you were there.
Who are you, kid?
They followed you here?
Who?
John Francis Walker! You are now harboring a fugitive element. Release her to our custody. You have 1 minute to comply.
Thanks.
Don't thank me yet. Tomorrowland. Here it comes.
Tomorrowland was a huge production with some incredible environments. I started doing pre-production phase in this project, and because I'd sort of got earned a reputation of being the organized one, schedules and all, I got tasked with assetizing every single building in that entire city. Doesn't sound like a whole lot of fun, but I knew that city better than anybody during that project. So whenever somebody needed to know where something was, they'd always come to me. Job security, it's good. I was also tasked with creating trees for us to use, so I got to use Speed Tree. I had a photography background, so I did this. I stitched and processed all our HDRIs that were taken on set, and I got to do some photogrammetry tests for some of the tree buildings that we had. I also picked up a bit of scripting, because I had to animate hundreds of cars and flying spaceships, and I really didn't want to do that by hand. So scripting helped. This shot here actually got cut from the film, but it got shown in the trailer. Very excited about that. I didn't get lost, because those canopies were really hard to figure out, so I'm excited I still get to show it. During the run of Tomorrowland, I also got the opportunity to work as a sequence lead on the rocket re-entry sequence that you saw in the trailer. I was responsible for checking in with the artists, relaying any notes, and making sure that they were on track to finish on time. I myself also worked on a lot of the shots in the sequence. And Tomorrowland was an incredible learning experience for me. I did things I had never done before on a scale I never even thought possible. It was very humbling and a little scary. But thankfully, I had a great lead in Barry Williams, who really nudged me along if he felt like I was getting stuck. This movie showed me the importance of stepping outside of your comfort zone. It's the sink or swim moment. It is terrifying. But you really don't have the option to sink. So you learn more in a few days than you would have learned in years. Tomorrowland definitely did that for me. Another project I got to work on was Agent Carter. And this was a reunion for me because Richard Bluff was the VFX supervisor on this. If you remember, he brought us on as apprentices in the first place. And Agent Carter was fun because it was a TV show. We had a much faster turnaround. So we really had to think about how we approach each shot. A lot of times we used digital in combination with practical effects. We also relied more on matte paintings. It's a long breakdown. So I actually worked on this sequence right here, and this was just a 2D bridge matte painting. The next project I want to talk about is Doctor Strange.
Stephen Strange. Might I offer you some advice?
forget everything that you think you know.
You're a man looking at the world through a keyhole. You've spent your life trying to widen it. Your work saved the lives of thousands. What if I told you that reality is one of many?
I don't believe in fairy tales about chakras or energy or the power of belief.
You wonder what I see in your future? Possibility.
Why are you doing this?
There are other ways to save lives. So much you don't know.
Obviously another incredible project to work on. Richard Bluff was the VFX supervisor again on this project, and we as artists got to explore all kinds of different ways to animate and essentially break the city. It was a lot of fun. I also got to test out new software again, one of them being Substance Painter. And this was when Substance was just becoming a big thing, and I was actually one of the first artists to test it at ILM, which was a lot of fun for me. This split river shot was my first shot on the film. I inherited this shot from our VFX supervisor. He had initially wanted to do it himself, but then I realized he wouldn't have enough time. So I got it. No pressure. And it was also going to be shown in the first trailer that you just saw. Awesome. Cool. Believe it or not, the most difficult thing to figure out with this shot was actually coming up with a lighting direction. Should we light every side from a different angle? Should it be a static key light? Should it move? What do we do? I ended up doing a lot of tests until we settled on what you see here. We obviously did a lot of really amazing and incredible things on this movie. Unfortunately, I don't have time to talk about all of it here. You may hear some more about it tomorrow, but we'll see how that goes. But I really felt that we pushed the boundaries of the technology we were using to new levels. We, as artists, were encouraged on a daily basis to, you know, be inventive, come up with creative solutions, think of new ways to approach these shots. It was incredibly inspiring, and I think it was that encouragement that started me to look into real-time rendering and game engines. What also helped was that my fiancé, then boyfriend at the time, had just left ILM for an art director position at a VR startup company. So I learned a lot about VR through him, and I was really fascinated. I was intrigued by the possibilities. So I decided it was time to learn Unreal. We work in a technology-driven field. New tools come out all the time. I mean, that's part of why we're here as well, right? We want to see where the industry is going. So if you want to stay on top of your field, you need to keep learning. It is absolutely essential to everything that we do. And not just as an artist, right, but also as a person. Because none of us are perfect, and there's always more to learn. I signed up for an online class at CG Master Academy. I signed up for their modular environment class. It's being taught by Clinton Crumpler, amazing teacher. And this is the environment that I created during the class. I learned a lot of different techniques about game environment creation, everything from asset creation to light baking to post-processing effects. It was an incredible class. I can only recommend it if you want to learn more about game pipelines. Now, while I was taking this class, our manager at work asked around if anybody had any Unreal experience, because ILM XLab was looking for additional help on a project that they had coming up. At the time, I was the only one, you know, sort of, I'm taking a class, I can do this. So I said, yeah, sure, I can do it. So after Doctor Strange wrapped up, I joined ILMX Lab for Carnegie Arena. Carnegie Arena was a VR experience about illegal immigrants crossing the Mexican border. It was directed by Alejandro Iñárritu, and it was going to be shown as a museum exhibit around the world. It was a very ambitious project, and the fact that we were going to create a photoreal environment with 10 fully animated characters. Now, this is in VR. You're familiar with VR. It needs to run at 90 frames per second. There are a lot of technical limitations we had to deal with. We had two environment artists, Matt Curler and I, and we had two desert landscapes to create, a nighttime and a daytime version. You see the daytime right here. At one point, Alejandro and Chico, his cinematographer, were scheduled to visit our studio, and they were going to stop by my desk and check out the daytime landscape I was working on. I was a bit nervous, because I hadn't worked with them before, and I didn't know what to expect. You know, some directors can be quite outspoken when they don't like what they see, but thankfully, my concerns were completely unfounded, and they were very nice, very appreciative of what we were doing, and they loved what I was doing. So that was a good feeling. I would say this project was definitely a highlight of my career, not just because it was a passion project for the filmmakers, but also for us. We were telling real people's stories, and we wanted to do them justice as best as we could. It did go on to win a special award Oscar, but I think for us, the biggest reward came from seeing people go through the experience. People would fall on the ground with their hands in the air. Some people were crying. It was a lot of emotional responses. And to us, that was proof that we had succeeded in creating an immersive story. And that's the best reward we could have ever hoped for. This is the trailer. In 2017, some personal things happened in my life. My mom decided she wanted to move back to Germany. That's where we're from originally. She had been diagnosed with cancer the year prior to that. And even though she was in remission, the doctors pretty much told us that it would only be a matter of time before the cancer comes back. So I started to look into getting a job in Europe so I could be close to her. Brexit was already looming on the horizon, so I didn't really want to go to the UK. And I'd also had a lot of fun working in Unreal. And I was really curious what it would be like to work at a triple A game studio. Now, if you remember, I didn't have any professional game environments that I could show. I only had one single exterior environment, and I had this half-finished interior. Right? It's hard to get time in for personal work when you're working full-time. So I said, I'll try it anyways. Let's just apply, let's see what happens. And sure enough, I received some rejections, but I also got some responses. And then I saw that Massive Entertainment was looking for environment artists. If you're not familiar with Massive Entertainment, they're the creators of The Division. I had played The Division, and I remember being completely blown away by how beautiful the game looked and by how much detail they managed to get in there. It was absolutely stunning. You haven't had a chance to play it, you should. I had also seen a featurette about Snowdrop, which I'm about to show you, actually. Snowdrop, if you're not familiar, is the game engine that The Division was made in. Now, before I show you this, I promised the team back home I would make sure you guys know this is from 2014. This is old. They're working on a new one, but it didn't get done on time for the conference, so please bear that in mind. We've added a lot of new cool things to it, so just bear with me on that one.
We wanted to create an engine that was capable of creating truly next generation of AAA games. But we also saw that as games were getting bigger, so were the projects working on them. And we wanted to go better, not bigger. And we all wanted to be smart and not rely on brute force. The engine should also support how we work in the studio, which is a lot of quick iterations on features, have a lot of creativity, and the freedom to experiment and prototype.
The core of the Snowdrop engine is a node-based scripting system. This is really the beating heart of the engine that allows us to do what we do. It affects all systems of the engine, from rendering to AI to mission scripting and the UI. It allows us to quickly develop our assets and to preview them and interact with them in ways that have never been done before in the industry.
It's so easy to use and to set up that you really have freedom and time to explore different options.
The editor is basically just a set of different windows that you can move around whatever you want. And if you work in a specific way, you can adjust the editor to fit your needs.
Working with the engine is kind of like solving a puzzle, because the components are usually already there. It's just a matter of how you combine them together.
You can do whatever you want. It's basically, it's like Lego, because it's just different building blocks, and you can test, does this fit here, more or less. You can make some really cool results just by very simple components. I really enjoy to work with it.
At Massive, I would call our work style a form of hectic fun. We're very busy all the time, and we like to use our talents to really try to make the best product that we can.
All right, the store was empty. I heard that gunfire.
There's always that chance of somebody's eyes glazing over and they realizing, but what if we do this? And that person runs out and comes back with this fantastic idea that somebody hasn't tried before. We're really creating something new and unique together.
With this power and with the usability in the tools, we saw that people really excelled in what they created. We got amazing graphics, we got new features, and we got unique innovations that we didn't expect, but that really pushed the engine forward. And all this was thanks to the foundation that the engine and the tools supplied.
Between the philosophy of our company and the power of our technology, what we've achieved is to empower our artists to really achieve levels of quality never before seen.
Pretty cool, right? So I asked a couple of my friends if they knew anybody at Massive, or if they knew what it would be like to work there. And again, small world. Two of my ex-lab coworkers did know people there, and they had heard nothing but great things about it. So they put me in touch, and before I knew it, I had an interview at 5 o'clock in the morning. Massive is in Sweden. Good times. But despite the scary moment when I realized this was going to be a video chat instead of a phone chat, meaning I had my job interview in my Baymax pajamas and dark under-eye circles, everything went well, and I got an offer. Now, when it comes to portfolios, I know you always hear this, but I'm living proof that it's true. If you have one or two amazing pieces in your portfolio and the rest are just okay, cut them. Just show your best work. Research the studios you want to work at. Show them that you can work in their style. If you want to work at Blizzard, show off your amazing hand-painted textures. If you want to work at Massive, show us that you understand PBR. Know your audience. If you come from VFX and you want to go into games, have at least one game environment in your portfolio. Show us that you understand the differences in techniques and tools. Same thing goes for if you want to switch from games into VFX. Now is your time to show off that high-res ZBrush sculpt and those 4K UDEM textures. If you want to include fan art in your portfolio, make it your own. Show what you can bring to the team that they don't already have. So, we packed our bags, moved halfway across the world to Sweden, and I started working on the Division 2. Now I'm going to show you some of the environments I worked on. Working on the Division 2 was an incredible experience. The team is absolutely amazing. Everybody gets to contribute, and you really feel the love and the passion that everybody has for making games. It's very inspiring, and it pushes you to do better. Snowdrop is also just as amazing as you saw. We really spend the majority of our time exploring different artistic visions because it is so easy to work with. We don't feel limited by the tools, so the majority of our time we just spend creating. And as a 3D artist, you know how exciting that is, because that's not always the case. So I think that about wraps up my presentation. Our new logo, by the way. You see, my career did not go as planned. Not at all. Complete opposite, actually. But every bump, every curveball, led me to where I am today. And I wouldn't want it any other way. Thank you so much for listening.